Hello, and in today's ATmega328P programming, we are going to be reading and writing to the EEPROM. For the schematic, nothing has changed since the last video, except that I moved the trim pot down to ADC3 instead of ADC5. This is for a later tutorial, but what we are going to do is we are going to have a reset counter. Every time the chip is reset, it will display the amount of times it has reset set on the LEDs. Okay, now let's have a look at the datasheet. Now the ATmega328P has a 1 kilobyte EEPROM, and it is organized in a separate data space in which single bytes can be read and written to. The EEPROM has a write erase cycle of 100,000 times. So after 100,000 reads and writes to a specific location in the EEPROM will give you either an inconsistent state or just not function at all. Then we have our EEPROM read write access. Basically, they just say here you can access it via the IOS. So registers and whatnot, you can directly access it from your code. Then they have preventing EEPROM corruption. Basically, just don't let your voltage fall below 2.7 volts during a write or erase to the EEPROM. There's two methods of preventing data corruption on the EEPROM. Is basically either have the brownout where it will reset the chip and keep it off until the voltage rises to an acceptable level, or have a reset protection circuit that basically monitors the VCC value before you write to the EEPROM. And then they have the IO memory space, which I just described some of the assembler instructions you can use with it. I'm gonna give this a skip as it's not that important, but it is good to have a read through. And then they have a description again of the general IO register. Again, good to read through, not that important. And then we have the registers. We have the EEPROM address register, which is split into two sections, the high register and the low register. So the high register will contain the upper half of the 16-bit addressing, and your lower will contain the lower half of the 16-bit addressing. Now this has a 1K EEPROM, so your addresses range from 0 to 1023 for the address space, so you will go all the way to a 10-bit address over here. And then we have the EEDR register, or the EEPROM data register. This 8-bit register contains the data that you want to write to the EEPROM. It will also contain the data that is read from the EEPROM. Then we have the control register, which is the base control register. Then we have bit 4 and 5, which is the EEPROM programming mode bits. These two bits select the state you want the EEPROM. We are only going to be using one state when we are writing to the EEPROM. Here they have the three states. Our 1-1 state is not used, it's reserved for further use, and the state we are going to be using is the erase and write in one operation. Now something to note here, this counts as a 2x a write to the EEPROM, since we are first erasing, so we clear it out, so basically it's the same as we write 00 or FFF to the EEPROM's value. Then we write an actual value into the EEPROM. Then we have the EEPROM ready interrupt enable. I do not recommend in general with EEPROMs to use interrupts on the chip, as it can corrupt data. So all interrupts will be disabled when we are reading and writing to the EEPROM. And something I forgot, you see this is as an atomic operation. That just simply means no other function in the programming space can access or change the values, the registers we are actively working with for the duration of that operation. Then we have the master write enable bit, and this bit, if you want to enable writes, then you have to write this bit to 1. So they state here EEMP is set, setting EEP within 4 clock cycles will write data to the EEPROM at the selected address. Then we have the EEPROM write enable bit. Now when this bit is written 1, it signals a write to the EEPROM. Now they have a bunch of extra stuff here that is actually more relevant to programming the flash of the ATmega328P. First we need to enable the master write, and then then we write enable to simulate, hey, we want to write to the EEPROM. And then we have the EERE bit, which is the read enable, and this just activates a read from a specific address on the EEPROM. And they give us some extra information about the read and write. And then we have two examples. We are straight going to be ripping the C code examples for the write, and then we are also going to be ripping the C code example for the read. And that is the registers covered. Now let's get to the coding. Now we have our base program set up here. We have a print buffer here, which we are going to use to print out values to the UART. Then we just have a constant here just to tell us the program has started. We set up our B and D port for the LED counter output. Then we have UART init at 9600. We print out the start program screen after we have enabled the interrupts. And then we are going to set the port equal to the value of run. Then we have a file for EEPROM.h, which will contain our EEPROM data, and then our EEPROM.c. Okay, now what we're going to do is, in our EEPROM.c file, we are simply is going to yoink the code from the datasheet for our read and our write. And now we are going to change the data types to uint16, because we are using a 16-bit value. It is going to return a uint8 for us, and we also need to change it over here to a uint16 and change it to a uint8 for our data. And we are going to make a slight modification to the read function. We are going to have it a pointer to, we'll just call it data. At the bottom, we are just going to set data equals to EERD. Okay, and that's our base functions. We are going to be modifying them a bit more. So we flick back to the .h file. Then we're going to say hash define EEPROM underscore size is 1023. So that is the maximum value of what our addresses can be. Then we are going to make an enum, and we are going to say the first enumerated value as EEPROM OK. So, and then we're going to say EEPROM write, and we say fail. We take again EEPROM invalid ADDR. Now these we are going to be using as error codes. So we flick back to the C file. Right at the top of the read, we add if, and we say the UI address is greater than EEPROM size. So if it's greater than the EEPROM size, we are going to return invalid ADDR, so invalid address, to the function. And then at the bottom, if we're done, we say EEPROM underscore OK as our return. Now we modify our write function also to return EEPROM OK. We add the same if to it for the register detection. We move those comma points to the correct place. Then we modify the address function. So it's EEARH for the high register. We say and 0xFF00 shifted by 8 to the right. So we filter out the upper half of the address and set it to the EEPROM H register. And then we say the low register, which is indicated with L. We adjust our filter to 00FF and we just set that to the low register. And then we take this code as well and add it to our write function. Okay, so the two functions have been modified as follows. We have now error return codes. We have EEPROM read, which takes in the 16-bit address, and then we have a pointer to the data. And if our address is out of scope, then we return from the function with invalid address. We wait for any write operation to complete on the EEPROM. Then we load in our address that we want to read on the two 8-bit registers, which makes our 16-bit wide address register. And then we start a EEPROM read. We take from the EEDR register and set data equals to that, and then we return EEPROM OK. And then on the right of the EEPROM, we say EEPROM write. This should be a uint8 as its return value. We take again the 16-bit address and we take in the data we want to write. If the address is greater than the EEPROM size, then we return invalid address again. We wait for the EEPROM to complete its previous write, if there is one. Then we load in the new address. We load in the data we want to write. Enable the master write. and then we start the write cycle, and then we return EEPROM OK. Now we are going to create a third function for uint8_t, and we call it EEPROM_update, and it takes in the same parameters as EEPROM write. We create a variable underscore of uint8 size, and we call it err for error, and we set that equals to 0. We can technically actually just set it to EEPROM OK so that we have it initialized. We copy our address code here, so it returns invalid address, and we create another uint8 and we just call it value, and we say equals 0. Then what we do is we go to our EEPROM read, we start that, we take our address in, and then we copy value, we reference to value our pointer, and then we take error is equals to EEPROM read, and we create an if, and we say EE not equals EEPROM OK. Then we return our error, and then we say if the value read from the EEPROM is equals to the data we want to write to the EEPROM, we return EEPROM OK. Now basically what we are doing here is we are reducing the write cycle to the EEPROM. So if you have the same value, there's no need to erase and read the EEPROM, because that will just waste the life cycle of the EEPROM if you're continuously reading and writing the same value to the EEPROM. And we start with the next section, which is if all these checks pass, we go to our EEPROM write, and then we simply just pass in our address and our data to it, and we say if it's not equals to EEPROM OK, then we return, and we return whatever the error code was. We duplicate the EEPROM read again for the section. Now the only difference is we are now checking if our data actually wrote to the EEPROM. Everything stays the same except for the value check, and we say not equals data, then we get our write fail return, and we paste that in, and then right at the end we return EEPROM OK. Okay, then we create another function which is also going to be returning uint8, and we call that duplicate EEPROM update, and we say batch, and it will take parameters of uint16 as an address. Our data that's going to come in is going to be void, so any data type we want to input, and we say uint16 and we give it the length, and right at the end this will return EEPROM OK. Now inside we declare a uint16, call it ice, so it's going to be an incremental counter. We copy our error, and then we create a uint8 pointer, and we call it data underscore cast. And that is going to be equals to a cast of uint8 as a pointer and data. So we are taking in a void parameter, so we don't know what data type this is going to be, and then under we cast it as a uint8, so we are going to handle it as if it is a uint8, since the smallest amount of data we can work with is a uint8. Then we create a for loop, and I equals 0 comma I is less than len comma I plus plus. Then we take EER is equals to our EEPROM update function as ERR, and that takes the address in, and it takes in our data, and our data is going to be incremented by whatever I is, and then the address is also going to be plus I. So we can write arrays, strings, floats, doubles, whatever we please into this, and then we just quickly grab a if not EEPROM OK from here, and we return the error, otherwise we return EEPROM OK. And now we duplicate this function, and we turn it into EEPROM read batch, and then we just grab our EEPROM Read function, and we reference to the data. So again, we can read and write any data type we want to into the EEPROM, and then return it back as we want it. Okay, now I need to add the functions to the .h file. Okay, now, so the EEPROM update batch and EEPROM read batch, I'm not going to be doing in this tutorial. I'm just putting it there because I'm going to have it on GitHub, and if anyone wants to use it. Now, let's have a look at our main function. Now, the first variable I'm going to declare is uint8 error, and set that equals to 0. Actually, I'm going to make it EER. Then the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to say EER is equals to EEPROM underscore read, and we are going to be writing to address. We can pick any address we want to. In this case, I'm going to pick 96, and we are going to set the variable run equals to whatever we are reading from the EEPROM, and then I have a printout pre-prepped here that will print out the value of the EEPROM. Actually, you know what, I need to have interrupts enabled before this, but since we are not using interrupts on the EEPROM itself, it is not that critical if we have the interrupts enabled or not, since we are polling the device instead of writing to it. And then we're going to declare a uint 8 again. We'll call it C for counter. We say that is equal to run plus 1, and then we're going to print out run plus 1 for us, and we say error, and we say EEPROM update. So we're going to update address 96 with the current value of C, because C is plus 1, so every time we reset, we read, we add it to run, we say run is C plus 1, and then we update the EEPROM with the value in C, and then we set the port B equals to the value of run, and we can move program start. I actually don't need this error variable here, but it is nice to use because I was using this during debugging the code originally. Then we can build our EEPROM, see if there is any errors. There is errors. Why is there errors? Warning, dereferencing void pointer. This should be data cost and not data as well in read update batch should be thing. Okay, so let's quickly build this. Now, as you can see on our putty printout, we have the value 19, which is the red value, and then value 20, which is going to be the new value on the next print cycle. Now, I've ran a few times. As you can see, I've reset the chip around 19 times already, just for debugging purposes. And then if we click reset, you can see it's going to be 20. So the next one's going to be 21 on the LEDs. And then every time I press, you can see the value increment by 1 and the value on the LEDs as well. And that's a basic introduction to using the EEPROM on an ATmega328P. A like, share, comment, and subscribe will always be appreciated. Thank you. Have a nice day.